Yo, HuddleTalk TV. Welcome to another episode, episode 26. Welcome everybody that's watching live on TikTok, guys. We're back at it. Another week. Weather's a lot better.
It is.
It was pretty trash yesterday. It was windy as hell. Knocked the power out in my apartment. Had to sit around and look at the ceiling.
That's like the epitome of a first world problem.
Yeah, bro.
Wait. Hold on. You had to look at the ceiling?
Yeah, because my
phone died. Was dead.
Yeah.
There you go. Shit.
So my phone died.
So what were you doing before your phone died?
I was actually going through my voicemail. I was like trying to clean it up because I don't remember the last time I've actually gone through my voicemail, which is kind of weird.
Yeah,
and I was thinking to myself, I was like, when was the last time I actually went through my voicemail?
I don't even think it's a thing. Do you guys pay for the premium voicemail?
No, not at all. What? I don't even use it. Why would I pay for it?
Well, okay, first of all, I text. I don't like calling in general, so I don't worry about all that nonsense. I can see why Nick, someone who literally calls every hour.
Exactly. Yeah. He would definitely leave some voicemails.
Yeah, I definitely.
I feel like if somebody has something to say, like they would text you, or if you know their number, then you just call them back.
Yeah.
You know,
Michael, are you done over there configuring? I feel like we need to restart this one.
Yeah, well, let's run it back. Yeah, what the hell?
Are we starting over again?
I think we can
keep going. Yeah. Okay, so Khaled, hit us with a topic, man, right away.
Okay, I was talking about the voicemail situation. So I was like, is that really a thing these days? Like, are people still leaving voicemails? Because the majority of the ones that I was looking through were like butt dials and stuff like that. Like, yeah. It was just like,
wait,
quiet.
What?
Yeah, it was like just quiet. You know, you could tell that, you know, the person either they didn't want to leave a voicemail and just like decided not to hang up like a douchebag.
Yeah.
You know? Or it was like, it's like
people
random,
are afraid
like,
to talk on the phone. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to be on a mixtape, right?
Or like, yeah, exactly.
It's
telemarketers, you know?
Yeah.
The fear of talking on a phone. I bet you that's a real thing. There's a phobia for basically everything, right?
Yeah, for sure.
One of the weirdest phobias to me is like the fear of like germs or like bacteria. Stuff like that.
Germophobia.
A germaphobe. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. Why is that weird to you though?
I don't know, because I've never been one to personally care too much about like bacteria and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Did you guys grow up with knowing like the 5 second rule? Did you follow that?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Did you ever like
you drop your candy and you blow on it? You're like, yeah, it's only been on the floor 5 seconds.
Yeah. So I did some of my own Googles.
Yeah. Okay.
this week, because I actually read more this week than normal, but the 5 second rule can go all the way be transferred all the way back to the 1400s.
What?
In Mongolia, when Genghis Khan was the ruler.
Okay, and how do they come about that?
So when Genghis Khan would have like big meals, if food ever fell to the ground, he created what was known as the Khan rule.
Okay.
And if he said that the food was still okay, once it hit the ground, then it was okay. Because food that was good for Genghis Khan was
good
easily
everybody.
Good enough for the basic people because it was looked at as really good food.
Yeah.
So essentially, I mean, they didn't know about like bacteria and all that kind of stuff back then, right? They just, it's dirty or it's not.
Who knows what that is, right?
Yeah. Microorganisms and all that. So all the way back to it was known as the Khan rule. And then, you know, thousands of years of later, it was all of a sudden the 5 second rule.
Yeah.
And the whole thing is bogus. Like the 5 second rule is a complete myth.
Obviously.
For sure.
Yeah, no, I know. But like literally they've literally done studies.
I can literally see the germs on it.
They've done studies on the 5 second rule.
Yeah.
And the moment it touches the ground, it is now 99% of the foods that will hit the ground are now covered with bacteria. Could be salmonella.
Yeah, could be other things. I remember. Okay, so let's talk about way back when. You remember the show MythBusters?
Yeah, of course.
So they did an episode one time, and they're talking about like how far does a toothbrush have to be away from a toilet when you flush it?
Oh yeah,
Khaled is gonna freak out about this. Okay. So every time you flush a toilet, there's whatever mist is in the air.
Yeah, your dookie air.
Yeah, so basically it gets on your toothbrush.
Oh.
So they did an experiment, like how far away, like if you just hover the toothbrush versus like in a cup on the counter. And obviously like to varying degrees, like God knows it was like 10 years ago when I watched it. But it was one of those things where it's just like, yeah, there's going to be trace amounts.
Well, that explains why a lot of people are still talking shit.
That's it. The podcast is done.
That's it. Mic drop.
Khaled has turned to me with the one-liners. Wow. He's become me.
Yeah, Mikey. So Genghis Khan. So the crazy thing about that is when you think back to like how ruthless that guy was, like as a leader, or I wouldn't even call him a leader. Like he was just a
he would.
I guess
he'd call himself a leader.
Yeah. And you guys know Napoleon Bonaparte.
Yeah.
You know the guy from France.
Oh yeah,
Bonaparte.
You know he wasn't actually short. You know, back then everybody was just that short. So he was like four foot something. Dude, and everybody clowned him.
Was 4 foot something was a norm then?
Yes, no. Yes.
Not 4 foot. It was like
he was like 4'11".
Okay, I was gonna say it was probably like 5'3" was like the norm back then.
Okay, well, whatever. So but bottom line, everybody was that short back then. Mm-hmm. Everybody just keeps getting taller. Mm-hmm. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. I thought we were actually getting shorter.
We've gotten taller and taller.
Actually, really? Over the past couple of years, like I'm sure there's like degenerative problems that are going to start associating with sitting down so much with people's spinal cords. Because like, honestly, you guys ever like hang, like you go to the gym and you go on like a pull-up bar and you just hang. And after that, you're like, I think I'm like half an inch taller.
Literally.
Literally decompression of your spine
feels like got stretched out. Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. I think that people will probably continue to get taller just because of the hormones in our food and everything.
Yeah. Facts.
It's not necessarily a good thing.
What is it? When every night when we sleep, our spine recompresses back out. Stretches back out to what is normal. Yeah. So throughout the day, you're tallest in the morning when you wake up.
First thing
in the morning when you wake up is when you're at your tallest.
Michael would know.
Throughout the day. I know. Okay.
So a short man
measures himself every hour
short
of the day.
Short king, man. 100%.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So, okay. And you know, obviously,
they
this
also
is,
say you're,
this
you're
is after you put your Tims on.
Yeah.
You're obviously taller.
Yeah.
but I think it's almost like, I feel like it's almost like half an inch is what you can shrink throughout the day. Yeah.
There's no, I feel like majority of that's got to be like posture though. Like for sure, by the afternoon, you're slouching your shoulders. Like
I don't even think even with the posture thing, I think it's like something just like that's how our spines are.
You're putting so much pressure every day, right?
What was the name that you decided? I know you were talking about it in one of the clips we saw earlier, and you're like, do your own research.
Yeah, do your Googles.
Honestly, that's like the like if somebody needs to know like what's your podcast about. Yeah.
Just do your Google.
Do your own research.
Yeah.
Like, I love that name.
We can't be held accountable.
Exactly.
No way.
For you guys.
That's hilarious.
We're a free podcast for the people.
Yeah, this is our free content. The more accurate shit is behind a paywall. So if you want more accurate information, it's about 70% more accurate. That hit us up in the link. And that's definitely going to be telling your friends a little bit more truth from that. Do you guys remember like growing up Lego sets? And, you know, that was the hottest thing. It was the best thing ever, right?
What was the hottest thing? Sorry.
Lego. Remember getting a fresh Lego set?
Yeah, right.
And the problem was, like, obviously, it was never as fun. Like, you never really took apart a Lego set. Like, you basically built it for, like, the model, and that was it, right?
Yeah. Then find a place to store it.
Yeah, and basically, you got to figure out where it's going to sit without breaking it. Mm-hmm. But I was laughing because Lego is doing this whole renaissance now where it's, like, Lego for adults. Have you guys seen that?
No.
I mean, Lego should be for adults anyways.
It should be.
Why do we got to outgrow that stuff?
Literally. But like what they're doing is they'll have like model pieces, like almost like stuff that you can like leave out. Like it's presentable. So there's like Darth Vader's like a helmet.
Oh,
like obviously cool things like
create
a
your
Super
own,
Mario.
Like, collectible
like
item,
exactly. Yeah. Like almost like a collectible type thing. Yeah. But it's like $150.
What?
Ooh,
and yeah, Lego's not even that cheap to begin with for like kid stuff.
Listen, but I'm not going out my way to buy Lego for $150. I'm sorry.
Man. That's what I'm saying.
I don't think you have a single Lego set in your house.
Yeah, it's not at all.
That's what I think when people really
I get PTSD when I see Lego.
Yeah, and I think that would be the coolest thing ever. Like in the future, if they have proper 3D printing where you just print your own Lego sets and people just have like blueprints for whatever, that would be super cool.
Take Lego off the market.
Take them out one shot.
Take them out. Yeah. But that whole Genghis Khan thing, man, it's kind of weird. Was that like something that he just implemented out of nowhere, or was like
that's the kind of guy he was? A rule for everything, right?
So if
he says this is how one thing's going to be, that's how it's going to be.
Yeah, that's a good.
And so this was his. I don't know how it like randomly transpired one day. Maybe
that's what I'm wondering.
Food hitting the ground probably happens pretty commonly.
Yeah. Probably happened to him.
Yeah. And so he just sat there and he was like, yeah, it's good.
Well, also,
meal looks good enough.
I also feel like back then, if it's something that hits the ground, like there's almost like this stigma around like. You know, I'm sure food was not that easy to come across back then.
Oh, definitely.
So it's like if you're a poor person, it's just like it doesn't matter. I'd rather eat this than die of
classism,
hunger,
right? You're like, this is what I can get for the week.
I think if you ask me, I think that's really the reason a lot of us stick behind that whole 5-second rule.
Yeah.
anyway, still today, is really just a saving food thing.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So let's
talk really about. It's really just a, well, we don't want it to go to waste. So.
Okay. So let's save face. You drop food. You're making a sandwich in the kitchen, in your house. You drop food on the floor. Eating it, yes or no?
Yes.
It depends on what it is, though.
Like, we're talking like
maybe. You're not going to pick up. Like, maybe like a little you made piece. Yourself some ice cream. You're not going to pick it up and put it back in the
No, not ice cream. No, no. Because there could be hair and shit on that.
Yeah, yeah. That's a little too wet.
Okay, so you drop crackers. Are you eating it?
Yes.
But crackers are just going to break apart. They're going to be done once you drop it, bro.
Maybe it's like a more resistant. It's a durable cracker.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. So you're eating it? Yeah. But like in public, if you drop crackers on the floor? No.
No, you can't. My home is clean.
Everything's a little. Yeah. Public is a little different too.
But where does it become like a pride thing versus like a dirty thing? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's just the fear of embarrassing yourself.
Yeah. So what are you saying? We should keep the same energy in and out of our houses? Everybody should pick it up.
I don't know. I'm just curious. Like, obviously, like when you're outside, I feel like when you drop food outside, like it's less gross.
What?
Like,
that's opposite of what I
thought. So hold on. Like if you drop something like in the grass, that doesn't like weird me out.
Why wouldn't it weird you out? How do you know if Betty was taking her well, wrong name, but let's just say
whoa, Khaled, whoa,
Michelle, yeah, okay, was walking her dog that morning and decided to take a dump on that grass there, and it's like,
what if it's in your backyard?
Wait, is the dog taking the dump, or weird me out is as much. Michelle taking the dump?
Why? If it was Michelle's, are you still eating it?
I think scientifically, dog poop has a lot of healthy stuff in it.
Oh, so
scientifically?
Scientifically.
Yeah.
Do your Googles. Is this a free version?
We can't confirm. We can't confirm. You go do that for us.
Yeah. Have you guys ever slipped in dog shit?
No, never. Thank God.
No, bro. Just stepped in.
I've slipped in it once.
Yeah?
But I didn't fall.
Your day ruined, right?
No. Yeah, well, it was funny the way it happened. Okay, so in...
Isn't slipping... The well, definition
I
of
caught fall, myself.
Like you slip.
I caught oh, myself.
Okay.
Oh, I almost wiped out.
Oh,
okay. So in Los Angeles, obviously perfect weather.
Yeah.
Never fucking rains, maybe like 4 days a year. So one time we went on vacation, and obviously everybody in Los Angeles, like downtown, you're either stepping in like homeless dog shit or homeless people shit or dog shit, right? Because there's no grass. It's all like suburbs. Like that's why there's all the fires. Like it doesn't get any rain, right?
Right.
So the problem is people are so fucking lazy over there. They'll have like fake turf or whatever. But if you have a dog, you know that doesn't work. Like a fake fire hydrant, it's like it's a feel good, but it doesn't actually work. Like a dog will shit where it will shit. Like it doesn't make a difference. Mm-hmm. But anyways, there's shit all over the sidewalks in Los Angeles. Outside these residential buildings. Mm. And we were walking one time, and my friend, Jeanette, she was like right up, like in front of me, and she fucking slipped on it.
So she fell.
She didn't fall. She caught herself.
Okay.
And then I was laughing at her, and then I fucking slipped on one that was literally another one, like right beside her. And it was disgusting. It was like in tandem. Like we both slipped on dog shit at the same time.
Oh my God.
And like it was a kind of slip where it's just like you felt like your leg like kicks out.
Yeah.
This was Great Dane shit.
I feel like in that type of situation, I've got to go back upstairs and take a complete shower. It don't even matter if it didn't touch my body.
Yeah, that's just one of those things. If karma was a thing, that was karma.
Even
for me?
Yeah, because you were laughing.
Okay.
Karma.
It's just like I don't know, like when we were younger, like when we used to get our socks wet, like for me it was like I felt so disgusted that I had to like I had to go back.
Okay, first of all, there's very
drenched.
there's very little feelings worse than having wet socks.
Yeah. Honestly. Wet, it ruins your whole day.
It does. It's unless you really just get used to it. Or like you're not even close to home and you have no choice.
You know,
and it's those ones that are just like that low key, like out of nowhere. Like, let's just say you like, imagine like you park your car on the side of the road and you didn't notice there's like a puddle there.
Yeah.
You step right out into it.
Okay.
That's a vibe kill.
But do you guys remember back in the day, we're talking like elementary school and all the bullshit, you have to wear your outdoor shoes and indoor shoes. And then you would come back and maybe one day you forget your indoor shoes and you wear your outdoor shoes inside and you just track all the fucking wetness through and the teacher would single you out.
Yeah.
Who wore their outdoor shoes?
Yeah. You left the evidence behind.
And then you wouldn't be allowed to like go for recess if you didn't have your outdoor shoes.
Relax, Ms. Demand.
Did she pull that shit?
She probably would be the type. Yeah, really? But I was still like 4 foot tall then. So
you could pull it off?
She treated me like a toddler.
Young Napoleon. Young Napoleon. She didn't know what you were capable of. Your ancestors. Young King.
God damn, bro. No, but what was up with teachers and calling you out like for those smallest things? Like,
yo. Facts. I don't know. But
always say, huh, Michael's got a small wiener. Like, come on, let me be.
Yo,
did you guys?
That's common today. I don't know about back then. The teachers today are different.
Did you guys ever have one of those scenarios where there was all of a sudden one day in the bathroom, there's like shit everywhere. Like one of those scenarios where somebody was like,
brother, where the hell did you go to school?
So I remember, so this was at, it wasn't me. 100% was not me.
Problem child.
No. It was literally, I remember one day somebody like took a massive shit and they smeared it on the walls.
Oh.
Okay. Well, do you have to shower hearing that right now?
Yeah. Yes. You're walking in the fumes, bro. That's you got to immediately call your mom and say, I'm feeling sick.
It wasn't me. And I didn't find out.
Walked out to the office.
I remember there was like caution tape. caution tape on the outside of the bathroom door, bro.
Somebody just killed the washroom.
They murdered it.
So Colin's clearly got the fear of feces.
Yeah, no, 100%.
Like, is that like your weirdest fear?
I'd probably be one of them. Yeah, for sure. Because it's like, it's going to leave a stench on you too. It's like, I gotta leave immediately. I have to take a shower. That's why I don't know, after you take a shit, like, don't you guys hop in the shower?
How many times a day? Hold on.
When you take a shit.
Like, if it's in the morning or if it's like after work.
First thing in the morning.
Well,
take a shit, I hop in the shower.
Yeah. No.
Is that a thing for you guys?
No.
Okay. I just laugh because I'm.
Let me guess. You just save toilet paper too and use your hands?
What?
I don't know. It's kind of weird. So I'm just going down that path.
No, you just took it to an extreme, brother.
You afraid of that?
I'm just laughing.
You gotta go watch yourself listening now.
I'm laughing because we're like 60 minutes in. All we've done is talk about shit.
Yeah. Well,
none of this is
shit and fears.
Yeah. And fears, yeah.
And phobias.
Yeah.
So true. Did you know that there are only two fears that we are born with? Humans. We're all born with the same two fears. Babies, toddlers.
Okay.
The rest of our fears that, whatever fears, phobias you have,
Is this
they're all learned.
So are these?
They're all learned phobias or fears throughout at some point in your life.
Okay, hit us with
this. Okay, do these two fears stay with us throughout our lives? Or is it just something that you're born with?
You might be, well, okay.
Or you learn to get
over them. I'll go over both. So okay. First things first, I'll answer your question. Fear is something that you can get over with. The more you're faced with something, the more potential you have to eliminate that fear or reduce that fear. The two innate fears that we are born with is the fear of falling and the fear of loud noises.
What?
Loud noises.
Yeah, so I'll explain. So
is that why we cry when we first come out?
Yeah, maybe because everyone's yelling. Mm-hmm. So the fear of falling, so what scientists did is they took a whole bunch of 8 to 14 month old toddlers and they put them on a platform, and at the edge of the platform they put clear plexiglass, right? And they had young animals too.
Okay.
And
Squid Game vibes.
Squid Game vibes. Literally, yeah, for real.
I was about to say that.
And the toddlers were too afraid to step off that ledge because they thought that there was nothing there. Humans just in general have the fear of falling.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And animals do too. And the reason we have that fear is for our survival.
And that fear, it's crazy because it even follows us in our sleep.
What do you mean? Like having bad dreams? Like when you're falling.
The body falling will wake you up.
Okay, so can you guys explain to me one thing? So Mike, I know you're going to give us a second fear story about that, but do you guys ever have, I don't know, maybe I'm a psychopath, but sometimes like when I'm like standing at like the edge of something.
Nice disclaimer.
And I'm holding something. Sometimes I just want to like throw it. Like you ever
yeah.
Like,
yeah. Okay. All right. You have a baby in your hand.
No, not that. I'm talking about like my phone. Like I don't know if it's just like constantly going through my head, like what would happen if like I drop my phone? Maybe it's just I'm looping this scenario. Not that I want to do it, but I'm just like this might happen. Like when you're close to an edge. Do you guys ever have that? Like
no, never.
Yeah. I wouldn't say that's like common for me, but I can understand it.
Yeah, I can.
Would you hold your how high over a ledge would you hold your phone over?
Come on, brother. I would not do that. Me of all people, you know that. It'd probably be dead anyways, but I wouldn't even try that.
So like 10 feet, would you hold your phone over a ledge? 20 feet, 30 feet?
I would say yes, because
give me something else other than a phone, man.
I've been on like hills and shit and take a photo. Yeah, I've taken photos and stuff where you're like literally at the edge. And
Yeah.
So technically speaking, yeah, I would. Like I trust myself. If I saw someone else doing it with my phone, I'd be scared shitless.
Bro, I have a fear of heights, so I wouldn't be able even to walk over to the ledge. It's too much.
Yeah, you were talking about this in the last one too. Yeah, like, that's the scariest way to die.
Bro, it's my stomach. It's just, I can't like.
Well, I mean, technically, that's the fear of falling. I know it's heights, but you're thinking about what it would be like.
Because I remember even when we went to, I think it was in the Elms. We did a, was it in the Elms, I think? Or maybe before that, actually. We did a trip to the CN Tower.
Okay.
And where we went to the top, obviously the glass floor and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
Bro, I could not stomach walking on that glass floor.
And that's crazy, like, too, because you love Wonderland.
My knees were so weak. Yeah, and it's weird. It doesn't make sense.
You just trust the roller coasters.
Yeah, exactly.
I got you.
Yo, I imagine in the future when we have like full-on VR.
Yeah.
You're going to be up in the sky.
Yeah.
And everything could be a glass floor if you wanted to. And you're going to be so zonked out, bro.
But don't you think
then he'd shit his pants and then he'd have to wash himself, find a shower?
100%. I would love if this podcast was in VR all of a sudden and make the floor disappear. We're above the city.
Yeah.
Callie's like, I got to stop. Thanks, guys.
I couldn't do it. I think I would still have that, like, where you feel like your stomach is dropping to your ass, like feeling, you know?
Mm, yeah.
No matter what.
Stomach is dropping to your ass.
Yeah, you've never
felt
that?
It's a common feeling. Googles it.
Yeah, you do your Googles. But like, for example, that feeling is like...
I think that's called twerking, bro.
Definitely not. But like when you're literally at like, for example, like the top of the drop zone.
Yeah.
And when you drop, that feeling where you feel like everything's coming out of your ass. Yeah.
Everything's coming.
It's just coming out of your ass, bro.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you just feel empty. It's a weird feeling, man. I don't know how to explain it.
True.
If you know, you know.
Yeah, but the anticipation is so much worse than like the drop,
oh,
right?
Yeah.
It's just like, when are they going to do it, right?
Yeah.
And then it's over before you know it.
Yeah,
it's
literally
over before you know
it. Oh, yeah. Like, if you're on the Leviathan or the Behemoth or whatever at Wonderland, any of these massive roller coasters, the wait to get up to that top is literally longer than the rest of that
ride. I can't do roller coasters.
And it's just like...
At all.
Going up, just slow. And you're like,
Yeah.
All of our hands are up.
No, I can't do them, bro. I get motion sickness so badly.
Really?
Yeah.
I get motion sickness like...
And
we're
pussy.
We're driving and if I'm reading something.
Yeah, same.
Yeah.
It gets really bad. Do it.
Motion sickness gets worse as you get older, right?
Does it?
Like, we basically are...
I don't know. I work from home now.
Unless the house starts moving.
Hey, yesterday was pretty windy, bro. Yeah, you kind of did a bit. It's kind of freaky.
Bro, that is actually so crazy, man. What?
Wait, actually, so what was
go ahead.
The other fear that I was saying, the fear of loud noise, it's so funny because, I mean, it sounds weird, right?
Yeah.
And I get it. But so basically the fear of loud noise is like, think of some things that are really loud. And the reason behind it is that, again, it's another fear that we are just born with.
Yeah.
And it's for our survival. Yeah. So both of these things, falling and fear of loud noise, are for our survival. And the reason is the brain goes into a fight or flight.
Yeah.
When you hear something, let's say like a friggin' bomb or like yesterday, the 100 kilometer an hour winds.
Yeah.
And it's like, maybe I'm playing a game or whatever, but all of a sudden
your body
like
just goes
immediately your brain, like you're scared and it's your brain.
Yeah.
Trying to figure out what's going on. Something dangerous could be around the corner. Right.
Yeah.
So those are the only two things that you're not taught. You're just born
innately
with.
Knowing.
Innately, these are your two fears.
Yeah.
Anything else? Spiders, snakes.
Or things you learn, yeah.
Anything else? Germaphobe. These are like cultural or things you can learn from your parents or people around you.
When I hear germaphobe, though, I feel like it's an extreme case. Like, for example, like those people that are constantly sanitizing and constantly cleaning things and making sure everything is like, once they put it somewhere that it has, that top area has to be cleaned again. Yeah. You know, I would think that's a germaphobe.
I
don't think you're that extreme, though.
Yeah, I feel like germaphobes is just underlying trust issues.
Yeah, seriously.
That's bars. Okay. Yeah.
Because like if you're afraid everything's dirty, it's just because like you think everybody else, like rightfully so, a lot of people are not clean. But
yeah.
It's like where does it actually? What's the real phobia?
I was at the gym the other day and I was coming. Oh, the gym is probably one of the nastiest places ever. Bro.
If you think about it, that's why I don't like thinking about that sort of stuff. Like,
yeah.
I just go do whatever, and I don't even put that stuff into my mind.
Mike is coming to the gym next Saturday, though.
Because if you do, yeah, I know. I'm joining him at the gym next weekend. So anyways.
Beautiful.
Go ahead.
So I was literally coming out of the washroom stall, ready to wash my hands.
Number one or two?
No, it was a one, man. Okay. I don't do number twos in public, bro.
Okay.
So I'm going to wash my hands, and the guy's at the urinal. He's leaving, and I see him at the reflection in the mirror. So the guy literally just leaves the washroom.
Didn't wash his hands?
Bro, the man did not wash his hands.
That's disgusting.
So I come out, finish, and this guy is in the gym.
No.
Picking up the weights. Mm-hmm.
That's disgusting.
I'm just like, bro, like, you could all do us like a favor by just washing your hands. and this wouldn't be an issue.
Man, the thing,
why are people like this?
The thing that like concerns me too is like there's so many dudes, you walk past them and they smell so
okay. Well, body odor, like you could have got your 24/7 like protection deodorant.
That's what I'm saying. It's cheap these days.
I'd love to look up to see if there's some sort of like survey.
Yeah.
Just randomly done anonymously, but I'm about like exposed dudes. I would not be surprised if it literally came out as 50% of men do not wash their hands after they go to the bathroom.
Okay,
but men are dirty. Men are just straight up. They're dirty.
Unhygienic.
Dudes are very unhygienic. Mm. So it would not surprise me if in your local gym, half of those dudes.
Let's not talk about that.
Took
anymore.
That like that's it wouldn't gross. Surprise. Me. Yeah. And but that goes back to exactly why I don't even like to think about that stuff.
Yeah.
Don't even put it in your mind.
What makes me feel a little bit better is now because of the whole COVID situation, they give you guys alcohol bottle and wipes or whatever when you're with you as soon as you come in the gym.
Yeah, that's not going away.
So I'm spraying down everything though. I'll spring that thing down, up and down.
Yeah. Facts.
So that's the one thing that came out of it that was good. So I don't know. But listen, advice to everybody over there: wash your hands.
Wash your hands is very good. So Mike, like in terms of fears, so those are like innate fears, and it's interesting if you read any book by Tony Robbins. One of the things he always talks about is you know there's a type of psychology, and they talk about like motivators for people. And we've talked about this before, but fear being a way, way bigger motivator than, you know, fear and pain are way bigger motivators for people than like pleasure, right? It's the whole idea of like the cave mentality, right? Like humans, you are safer in the cave, and you are taught that like if you take a risk, the chances, it's not that like you fail. Like modern day, if you take a risk, the worst thing that can happen is like you fail at something, you get to try again. You fail in the olden days,
shout out to Aaliyah, dust yourself off and try again.
There you go. That's it. So, but like we have so many years of behavior learned that's just like, you don't take risks. You don't do that. Cause the risk to reward is like, maybe you get some food, but you could also die. Right.
Yeah.
So a lot of humans, that's why we're like literally hardwired programmed to be more afraid of things than like the fruit of the reward for it. Right? Like it's just the negative outweighs the positive, which is crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the things I did want to talk about is speaking of that is it's interesting. So New Zealand, did you guys hear the news?
Tobacco.
So tobacco, they basically banned the sale of cigarettes to anybody born after 2007. So I think that's interesting because I remember there was probably like a year ago, maybe 2 years ago. And I remember just think distinctly, this is like the hype of like the vapes everywhere, right? Jules. And I remember I saw this one kid who was like 16 and he's walking down. He's like, maybe he was skateboarding or something. And I remember he pulls a cigarette out and he lights it. And I was like, what the hell? Why is that kid smoking a cigarette? But I was weirded out because I caught myself. I'm like, wait, like that's weird to me. Cause I remember like when we were growing up in high school, there's a smoker's bridge outside Airedale, right? And everybody had like the smoker's corner area, right?
Yeah,
obviously every kid vapes now. So I remember seeing this one kid at 16. I'm like, why would this kid be smoking when he could be vaping? And it's true. It was like a weird thing for me. Yeah. I'm like, why would he pull out a cigarette?
At least get like some flavor or something.
That's what I'm saying, man. So I don't know. It's interesting, like 2007. So basically that's officially the death of it, but I don't think that changes anything. Like that's, how many people born after 2007? Like, it's such a feel good fucking politician thing. How many people are actually going to pick up a pack of cigarettes and be like, yeah, I smoke? Pretty much nobody.
No.
It's so inconvenient.
Another thing, too, with me is there's so many things that you could tackle and attack that are bad for you.
Yeah.
Right. You know, I'm sure if you look at the stats, smokers probably, especially in their later years, overwhelm the health system.
Probably.
I'm sure they do.
Yeah.
So with alcohol. So will alcohol, fast food.
Yeah.
So will so many things.
Marijuana.
So I just...
Marijuana.
Marijuana. I don't know about that one. I don't know if that's overwhelming the hospital system. Wow. No, the health system.
It's overwhelming the Harveys and McDonald's.
It's over.
The drive-thrus.
Yeah. Maybe because now they're eating a lot of fast food.
Yeah.
The Taco Bell. So now they're having health problems. Yeah, in fact.
Yeah.
Maybe you're on something. But yeah, it just seemed weird. And it did seem like a feel-good... political random thing.
Yeah, like
because obviously they made the headlines like, oh, they're going to be banning cigarettes. Oh, wow. Round of applause for them.
That's such a great job. And I was laughing because it was like one of the most upvoted articles on Reddit. Mm. Like people need to go outside. Like people don't really smoke cigarettes anymore. Like young kids are not smoking cigarettes.
That's young kids,
they're smoking their vape.
Yeah.
You know?
It's such a small counterculture of people smoking cigarettes. And like you're doing it to do it. So that means those people will still... fucking smoke the cigarettes.
When we were
chain smokers, they're going to continue doing.
They're going to find a way to do it for the image.
Yeah. When, as far as I remember, when we were growing up, kind of like the middle school, high school age, there was quite the push against tobacco.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And it, by the time we got to high school, in our heads, it was kind of like, it wasn't cool to smoke for most of us. And it was like, you catch someone smoking and it's like, why is that person doing that?
That guy's a loser.
Yeah. Just, it would almost be like that. Now, when we got to high school, you'd have like the grade 12s and 11s be outside the front and they'd be smoking.
Yeah. Yeah. Normal.
But the grade 10s and 9s. And then when we got to 11 and 12, we weren't.
Yeah.
We weren't Nobody those people cared. Anymore. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. It was just, you know, you smoke weed.
Yeah.
You know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Cigarettes was not the move.
It was not a thing that...
It wasn't badass anymore. No. That's why people started smoking, because it was badass.
It was it's a way to look cool.
Plus, it smells horrible.
You know what? I think I remember it was probably like grade 7. And I remember that was around the time where everybody started getting like a home video camera and you started doing like these tech comm projects where you would have to make like a 2-minute video with your friends. And that was around the time, I think like 2007 was probably like peak Jackass days. Mm-hmm. Remember those?
And
I remember, and it's just like, if you wanted to be badass, you started doing stunts and shit. Like that was like, that Jackass was pretty much like the kickoff to like the YouTube days.
Yeah.
And everybody's like, oh, I can film these home videos for these comm tech projects and then throw it on YouTube and all that. And I remember that shit. And I feel like that was like, all of a sudden people were chasing that different high on the internet.
Yeah.
I literally feel like the internet, like probably like there's nothing edgy about it anymore. If you want to be cool, go online.
Yeah.
Like literally like nobody really cares. And do you guys remember, I think it was in like grade 9, grade 10, Epic Mealtime.
Yes. Epic Mealtime. Yeah.
Do you remember how fucking exciting that was to discuss every week with your buddies? Did you see the newest episode?
I don't even remember.
You don't
this
remember that?
I don't remember
the
it. No.
Fuck.
Please jog my memory.
So, dude, they would go through like a McDonald's drive-thru. And this was like back in the day where like McDoubles were like $1, right? Mm. And they would go in there and get like 40. But to us, it was like, holy cow.
Yeah, yeah.
They would spend like $100 between like 10 guys. It's like $10 each, like per dude. And they would be like, we're gonna make the world's biggest fucking McDouble. And they throw all the patties in one stack, and then Muscles glasses. He was like, literally would just eat it, and they'd all like devour it with sauce and all that. It was the craziest thing. And I remember that was like the early hype of YouTube days. That was like the shit. Those guys are still running those videos. They're Canadian.
I know they got replaced by
mukbangs.
Disgusting.
Yeah. I was gonna say they're Canadian, but it seems like the most like American thing to do. Just massive, massive meals and stuff like that. But yeah, I didn't know they were still a thing.
I think you were telling me some guy from Mississauga. You were telling me that.
Furious Pete, man. That dude does eating. That dude like is like legitimate eating contest, like world renowned. Like, he's a fucking monster. Wow,
he's big time.
He's big time, man. He's got like 6 million subs or something. He still gets stupid views.
Never mind. He has big time.
He's huge. But yeah, that guy's story is phenomenal. Eh? So
yeah, what's the story?
He had cancer. And he struggled with that and battled with that for quite a while. And basically one of the big things he had to do when he was like super, you know, is super frail from it is, you know, after the chemo treatments, like he would have to force himself to eat.
Yeah.
So he learned how to just eat maybe I'm totally wrong on this, but I swear I remember hearing a documentary about him learning, saying like, hey, I can do this. Mm-hmm. Right. And so he just started practicing that and getting to food competitions and competitively eating. And man, Matt Stoney is one of the other like top dogs of the fucking scene.
Yeah.
And that guy will shovel like 28 hot dogs in his mouth.
That is like, how do you practice? Like, how do you get your stomach to be able to take all that food?
That's insane.
It just mentally, I can't even fathom it.
It's just like you feel so unwell.
Yeah.
I think the most hamburgers I've ever eaten was like 16 junior chickens in like one sitting.
Okay, see, that's even crazy. Like, that's nuts. I've never even taken to the.
Most I've had in like one sitting order maybe from like some two? Fast food, like four.
What?
Like four or five.
Four is like a snack.
Yeah, no, I know, because you're
a
freak.
Are crazy, man.
I can't do like 16 junior chickens, like unwell. Like you're unwell after that. Like you want to puke.
What?
After 16 junior chickens.
Of course.
Like, I'm not saying it's a normal
You should want to puke after normal, like six.
Yeah, true.
I know they're small, but that should be the norm. Like it's probably, you got people over in Europe like listening to this right now, disgusted with you.
Yeah. Bro, I don't understand how they can do that. Like, and then to go, like drink it down with soda and stuff is like,
how? Like overeating has got to be something that's been trained to us. Like that has to be like a learned thing, because that is not a normal human thing.
It's not
just easy to eat. Like that's a boredom.
I feel like it turns into
it could be subtle too, because like you're always, if you catch yourself, you like if you're watching a show or something like that, you're like snacking,
mindless eating.
Yeah.
I really, you know what I'm really disappointed about? I really like, so Chelsea and I got really good barbecue like 2 weekends ago.
Yeah.
And like brisket, obviously super freaking good. Like smoked beef. And you know, obviously every dude in his 20s now wants to go smoker, wants to, you know, brisket and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And I hate to turn this into a boomer podcast, but like, man, it is so expensive. So the price of ground beef or the price of beef, I was just looking at Reddit, in Canada, it's gone up by 20% in the past year.
Doesn't surprise
me. Everything else in the basket is up by like 7%. Gas is up like 7%.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Beef is up 20%. So I'm like, goddamn, like literally to buy fucking a thing of brisket. Like I was like, okay, maybe you make it yourself and you have a lot of food and it's really good. And it's kind of like a hobby, right? You know, there's worse ways to spend your money, but it was so expensive, and I was like, "Fuck!" There goes my dream.
They were. I was reading.
That's your dream.
There goes my dream of eating too much brisket.
Yeah, damn it.
Till I fall asleep.
I
read a headline because I didn't decide to read the article.
No, yeah, totally cool.
Yeah, so they were saying that by 2022, families are going to be paying like $1,000 more for groceries.
Yeah, that's
crazy. On the year. Yeah, yeah, that doesn't surprise me either. Yeah,
that seems like a low end, but.
It's been a bit.
Do like your Googles, by the way.
Obviously, I've shared a couple of things with you. Mostly, I was doing because of Nick, because I know he's always talking about grocery prices.
Yeah.
But it was literally this last week on Reddit Ontario. It's been a trend to post your grocery bill.
Really?
And like the image of what you got.
Show your haul.
And show the price of it. So
yeah.
The first person who did it got like literally nothing substantial in his food. He only got like sliced meats for sandwiches and then like chocolates, cat litter, stuff like
that. Nothing for a meal, basically.
And it was like a really small little thing on his table. And it was like $81 or something like that.
What?
And he's like, this is $81. Like just showing. And then people were kind of roasting him. Even people who agree that.
It's the internet, man. But
people were roasting him because it's like, okay, well, you have no right to complain because you went and bought like $20 worth of chocolate. What do you need chocolate for?
First of all, it was $6.
Okay, whatever.
I know those chocolates. No, but you're right. Because the Reddit comments were saying $20.
Okay.
I was auditing that. I was like, everybody's wrong.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the other thing was like,
you got to prove them wrong.
And I know this because I love sliced meats for sandwiches, so I know how expensive they can be. Mm-hmm. He literally got like the most expensive and like hardly any meat too. And it was like each of the little packs that have like six slices was like $6. So he spent like $12. I'm like, it's like you can get like twice that for like $7 combined instead of $12. So it's like he wasn't a great shopper in the first place, but it has become a trend on Reddit Ontario where people are showing their bills. And even the people that are like crazy couponing, you do the math and it's like, this is still silly. Like, how is like these six things $40 and it doesn't even make your meal?
Yeah, it's true, man. But anyways,
we can't even get a bag of chips.
Yeah, we won't talk about that anymore.
Without it's putting so a hole in your pocket, man. Mm.
That's true.
It's crazy.
Khaled, I know you're going to have... Yeah.
Sorry?
No, keep
going. Go ahead. No, Khaled, what?
I was going to say, you're going to have no input on this.
What?
I was going to say, Mike and I were talking a little while ago about the names for weed.
Mm-hmm.
And we were just laughing, like craft, you know how craft breweries, so like, you know, craft beer drinkers, like
IPAs.
The reason like they buy craft beer is they'll look at it and they'll be like, yeah, that container is kind of cool. I'll buy it.
Yeah.
And anybody who tells me otherwise, full of shit, because all craft beers taste the same. Oh, this one's got a hint of, hibiscus or blueberry. It all tastes sweet and hoppy. Like it's gross.
Yeah.
Like anybody who says otherwise is hilarious. But I laugh at it because, you know, there's obviously a whole like artisanal market around these craft beers and like what people think they should buy. And, you know, it's all about the funkiness of the branding. And Mike and I were laughing. We're like, people naming weed, it's like the same convention. Yeah. Like you call, like there's like strains called like Thunderfuck.
Or
like Blueberry Monsoon. It's like
Purple Haze.
What is that? What does this mean?
Yeah.
What does this mean?
I think they just pull these names out of their asses, honestly.
They do, just for the hype of it.
Yeah.
And it's just like the craft beer purification of everything. It's just a marketing.
Yeah.
Way. Yeah, that's...
It's like this... It's this hippie... They've all got like a colorful design that sells. Mm. And the name, it's just like, oh, that's kind of cool. Like,
I remember one of the first beers in the beer store was the craft beers was like, it was like the Flying Monkey, I think.
Yeah, exactly. And it was exactly like the kind of names.
It was a cool can that everybody, all these microbreweries started popping up and like copying, you know, the designs of that and like the funkiness of the can. I'm like, so funny enough too, like obviously, you know, if you watch podcasts, you know, most of these big guys are sponsored by Liquid Death, like the water.
Okay.
Basically it's just like water in a can. It looks like you're drinking a beer. And it was hilarious because the story behind this is basically it was a dude who worked for like a marketing company or one of these big Silicon Valley companies. I can't remember. And he basically said like marketing is stupid and I'll show you. Like you can market anything. So he basically decided to market a thing of water and, you know, Liquid Death. And you open it and there's no carbonation. Like there's no like, you know, pop when you open the tab. Yeah. It's like you open it and you're like, oh, this is kind of like just below room temperature water.
Yeah.
It doesn't taste good. Like it's just water. It was hilarious.
That's weird. I mean, I get that kind of... The closest thing I've been to a beer is probably a Barbican.
What?
That's probably the closest thing. Really? I've been to a beer, yeah.
That's funny, man.
Just the look and everything.
It's crazy to me how they managed to sell the world on bottled water and just pricing it. Dasani, Aquafina.
First of all
that stuff. And it's just like the amount that people are spending for this. I guess they're not all. I mean, that's one thing where we're from. I don't think we realize how fortunate we are to have like fresh water and then the amount of water we have. Let's get it straight,
though. Dasani is better than people say this. People clown on Dasani all the time, bro.
So you think it tastes different?
I like Dasani.
I don't mind Dasani, but Aquafina just has like this aftertaste, this weird aftertaste, bro.
You think so?
For me, yeah. For me, yeah. What about you guys?
I straight up don't drink bottled water enough. Like, I almost never drink bottled water.
Bro, you just your filtered water at home?
Yeah, or I just drink straight from the tap.
Straight from the tap. From the Brita.
There's no
Since I've been because it's there, but at home I literally always drink from the tap. I swear
we got him again. Really. We got him again.
No, sometimes I still drink from the tap here if I'm just too lazy or whatever.
No wonder you got the hat on, big capper.
Got you.
No,
bro.
The way I look at it, especially when I was young, it's just, bro, sometimes you just put things in your system and it's viewed as not great, but it builds your immune system.
Yeah, yeah. No, for sure. For sure. I'm not going to sit here and lie and say I haven't drank any water from the tap before. But ever since I've been drinking filtered water, it's just you can't go back, you know? And plus,
that's true.
Ever since I discovered this bubbly, thanks to you guys.
100%.
Bubbly. Bubbly water hits different.
So, one of the things I want to talk about is, and this is the last thing, and Cal, you bring up some topics.
Yeah, for sure.
But I was laughing. You remember back in the day, so think back to like grade one, kindergarten, okay? Stop, drop, and roll. Okay, remember these little limericks? And I was convinced, I remember growing up, I was fucking convinced at a certain point in my life, I would catch fire. Like it was a matter of time.
They remember sold
We learned this shit. They're like, what do? And there would be like the whole animation to it. Stop, drop, and roll, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And you would practice it like rolling around on the ground. And teachers would like, I was certain it was a matter of time in my adult life where I would be catching fire and I would need to rehearse this.
That's nuts.
But I remember this shit and I was laughing because I'm like, man, probably the modern day equivalent is like protect, enforce, and capitalize for like password protection. You know what I mean?
Wow.
Kids these days, bro.
Definitely.
randomize, capitalize,
you have no right. You have no right to call us freaks anymore for anything, okay? So what if I like pimples? I was gonna catch on fire.
But bro, honestly, like grade one kids are probably taught password protection, and I feel so badly too because I remember growing up too. I don't remember how long ago I heard this. People were talking about like, oh, like in the future it'll be so hard to get a username. You know what I mean? With that, like, with like a letter or a fucking number or like 65. Yeah. This Mike 001. You know,
asterisks numbers. Bro. Like, oh my god. It's so hard.
It is.
It's so hard. They really got to remove like the unused usernames on databases.
They
got to
purge
point.
These people, man. Yeah,
they
got to purge
stuff.
It's digital graveyards, bro.
They should be able to delete those somehow.
They should just wipe them, bro. Yeah. The metaverse will wipe them. Don't worry about it.
I got trust.
Remove them.
Yeah.
And did you guys see the other post too about Ukraine and Russia? These guys are throwing shade on Twitter.
They're going at each other.
Of course they are. Very 2021.
Like World War II, what was it? Franz Ferdinand.
I guess Russia's saying, "Yo, Ukraine should be ours."
Bro, so Ukraine is from like an official like Ukraine account, like God knows, like a government account, whatever it is.
And no, verified.
Verified, and it shows a picture of like a headache, like red, like focus, and it's just like when you're hungover, and then there's another one of like when you forget to pay a bill or something, and then like a massive red like headache, and it's like when you live next door to Russia. I'm like, bro, this is petty, but it's good. Yeah. Like, imagine World War III starts like that. That was
we've really reached a point where like nothing's serious. Everything is trolled. I just don't get it, man.
Yeah, it's everything it's is so sticking funny. A joke. Because I was laughing because the other day, speaking of that, there was a basketball mascot. It was the Chicago Bulls mascot, right?
Yeah.
So he was doing like a TikTok trend.
Benny the Bull, right?
So he's doing like it's this trend where you're supposed to have the face scans you. It does your iPhone face ID scan, right?
Yeah.
So then he gets his phone and he's like, okay, so I got to scan who the New York Knicks are, right? And he scans like a trash can. And it shows this is the face ID and it just unlocks, right?
Yeah.
It makes that unlocking sound. So it's like, I was like, yo, this is crazy how these like trends are happening and stuff. It's nuts, man. Jokes.
Have you guys seen that girl on social media, mostly TikTok, where she's like, she starts off her trend with that she was a graphic designer. in college. Okay. You know, she took a course or something like that. And she had responded. No, she had responded to some big company. It wasn't like McDonald's first, but it was someone else. And she just said, I really don't like your logo. Like, I think it's done really bad. And I personally took a course in college in graphic design, and I think it should look like this. And it was like some horrible joke. Like, it was all just parody.
Yeah.
And the company actually reached back out to her and was like, oh, we love it. And they like put it as their image.
Yo, she did this to Dana White too.
Yeah, she did it to the UFC. No way. She ended up because of the one thing she did. She's got like millions of followers on TikTok now. And she's basically any big brand you can think of.
Works
across, you know, F1, the UFC, every personal sports team's logo. And she just trolls and makes their new logo, and they all start posting it everywhere on their like official accounts. She did like Windows and like their like not Times Square, but like their New York City Windows location, put it on their actual store.
No way.
And it, the Windows was, it's just four squares, and it's her face in the four squares.
No way.
And she was on there, and she's like, she couldn't believe
that's
it, right?
Crazy.
Like, it's crazy how you can just.
The power of the internet, like how your life could just like.
Honestly,
she did Detroit Lions.
Yeah.
She did. She wrote like Detroit, like on squiggly, like Photoshop sort of thing, like terrible writing, and then put like four lions.
Detroit Lions.
And like, everything was just a joke, right? Like,
man, the one that she did with UFC and Dana White.
What was the UFC one?
Bro, I can't even remember. It was so funny. Like, she had the wrestlers totally wrong, and she changed everything. It was hilarious.
Just made it a mess.
Yeah, dude. But it was interesting. There's this one YouTuber I follow, and his name Brandon Buckingham, and the guy does hilarious, you know, skits and all that. But it was really interesting. One of the things he mentioned was he put out a video every Thursday. He puts out a video. And his newest one on Thursday is he put out this video saying, hey, I've been meaning to put this out for a few weeks now. And he's like, I want to tell you guys about how I feel being a YouTuber now, doing this for like the past 18 months, not missing an upload. And he's got like 80,000 subs now. And he's like, I've had more anxiety than I've ever had in my life doing this. And he's like, every Thursday I post, I fear that that's going to be the one that ends me. Mm. That's the one that doesn't catch the algorithm. And, you know, I'm going to become a complete failure. And 18 months is basically wasted. And, you know, it's funny hearing that. Well, it's not funny, but it's just, it's wild to know that every single person, like imagine even this girl, like not to take this dark term, but even this logo girl, it's just like
she's
have
on a
your
high
15
right
seconds of
she's
fame
on a high.
And then how quickly you shoot up, you fizzle out because the next thing has happened, right? Mm-hmm. The 15 seconds of fame now is real.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, it is. That's it wild.
I mean, it's a fear everyone who's in these situations going through. Maybe they don't talk about it, but they're all going through the same
anxiety,
thing, right?
Man.
Yeah.
What if the next one doesn't catch, right?
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Yeah. Like, especially when you have so much success in something.
Yeah.
And then for you to not be like, just to go out like that, and you become irrelevant, basically.
Yeah.
You know,
it's just taken over. It's just like you have all these expectations for growth and trajectory, and like, oh, this is where I could end up, and. Just like, wait, nothing happened the way that I wanted it to.
And then you know what even sucks more than that is like the people that have those 15 seconds of fame and don't get the opportunity to monetize.
Yeah, they missed the shot.
They missed the shot.
Fumbled the bag.
It's another reminder that if you're going to be doing something, do something
what
you
love.
Yeah,
because
yeah,
if it's not successful, at least you love doing it.
Exactly. You just love doing it. Because and that was an interesting thing this guy talked about. He's like, other people that he knows, obviously, that have tried, like, obviously, you start meeting other people that are in the YouTube space, and, you know, you become a little cloak gang and all working with each other.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
He's like, the amount of people I know that have put on this internet personality for a year trying to make this thing happen, and then they realize they're just an entertainer, and this isn't who they are.
Damn.
And it's just like, oh, my God, that's so real.
Yeah.
That's just, it hits so close to home, and that's the fucking crazy thing.
And then people expect you to have that face on constantly.
Exactly. That's who you are.
Like, that's the scary part.
Yeah. It's just like you're living this double life. But anyways.
That is messed up. Yeah.
Cal, give us some funny news, man.
Oh, no. Not too funny, but like I was just going over like some interesting inventions that were actually came about by accident. So
you love this topic.
So, yeah.
But don't ask me for this resources.
You make sure you do your Googles. All right. Before I say any of this.
Do your research.
All right.
Do your own research.
We're going to start off with my boy from New York.
Okay.
George Crumb. So George Crumb actually created potato chips, and this was actually by accident. So
damn,
this kind of ties into groceries being so expensive, how we were talking about earlier. And one of the main things that we actually always go to the grocery store is potato chips. So George Crumb was actually had a restaurant, and he would sell fries there. So the people were actually growing impatient and didn't like his fries anymore. They weren't crunchy enough. So what he did was he decided, you know what? I'm just going to slice up these potatoes as thin as possible.
Yeah.
Dump it in some oil there, and then add some salt. And it became a hit. Like, people started loving it. And it was just by accident. It was actually because people were actually pissed at him for not making potatoes crunchy enough that this guy ended up cutting them up. Make them thin
probably
as possible.
Probably cook faster too. Cook
yeah, probably
way
yeah,
faster.
Yeah.
Way faster.
Damn.
So you know, covered it up in salt, and there you go.
Pressure. Wow. Pressure makes diamonds.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh,
there you go.
You already know.
That's how we got our man. Jason Tatum flavor now.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
You want? I know. We've had. You know, this has been like a more serious podcast. But you said you wanted some funny news. You know, for the banter. Did you guys hear about the guy from the UK who got the artillery shell stuck up his ass?
Yeah.
No. Wait, Cal, yes.
Of course I heard that.
This guy.
Of course I felt heard that. Not literally. So a guy rushed into the accident emergency room at the hospital.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's got this like massive tank artillery shell up his ass. And he's in like extreme pain. They had to call the bomb squad.
They had
to call the bomb squad because they were in fear that maybe it would explode.
Yeah.
So this guy shows up and he's got to have a story, right? Mm-hmm. Why is this thing in his ass? He's like, well, I'm a big, you know, World War II enthusiast, World War I enthusiast. And I just have these collections around my house. Well, it was on the ground and I just happened to slip and fall and I fell right onto it.
You freaking freak,
weenie.
He's not goofy. You knew exactly what you were doing, buddy. Yeah.
And the
exactly what you were doing.
they said the ladies or whatever that worked there that had to help him retrieve it out. They said this is not necessarily with the artillery shells, but this is a daily occurrence, especially with men show up to their accident and emergency facility
with things up their ass
with large objects stuck in their ass, and they all make up a story. Oh, I slipped and fell on it. It's crazy.
Be
it's like,
honest
wow.
with yourself.
Be honest with your fetishes.
Be honest with who you are.
Yeah. Be open.
It's crazy because
keep your booty closed, but be open.
what did Jeff send us? He told us like you can. There's a study that showed that like you can, like the human rectum could fit like two raccoons in their ass or something like that.
Oh yeah, and I said I can probably fit three.
Yeah,
that's what I said. I bet.
What?
You always feel like you have the need to one up, right? Do you ever get that?
Of
like,
course.
Very exactly. So this isn't weird. I bet I can fit three.
Hold on.
I gotta stretch this
hold
out.
On. Hold on. So can we rewind? First of all, the artillery shell thing. Where'd you find this article?
Google.
I did my Google.
I don't remember.
You know. So where did Jeff find the one about the raccoons?
It was on. Oh, it was on Instagram.
Instagram somewhere.
Yeah.
So how do we know if it's peer reviewed? So basically, we've taken something that's fake
and well, made my it, story made isn't fake. I'm just.
His story is 100% real.
My story.
Jeff's story's fake.
100%.
Yeah, my story's real.
So you just told us like, a soundbite, and this is like 30 seconds later. By the way, guys, it's all completely fake.
Yeah, but the point of it is hopefully our listeners come back to me and say, I can fit four.
Yeah.
And then that's where we go back and forth. It's like, well.
We're not encouraging being freaks out here.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, Mike, you keep that to a separate show. Keep that sideshow on your own.
Speaking of.
Private profile.
Speak of fetishes.
Fetishes. Okay. Speaking of. The motivation and want to like just one up someone else.
Yeah.
Have you guys watched any Netflix lately?
Money Heist. That was about it.
Just Money Heist.
When you're telling me about.
So there's a new documentary, maybe like a week old or more on Netflix. It's called 14 Peaks.
Yeah.
Highly recommend.
Oh damn! I was gonna watch that. Yeah.
So friggin' good, man. I loved it. This guy crazy. Guy from Nepal. Mm. Nims Purja. Okay, this guy Nims Purja from Nepal sets off in 2019. It was just before the pandemic. And he sets off to break the world record and summit the 14 peaks that are above 8,000 meters. So the 14 tallest peaks in the world. and he's going to summit them in 7 months.
Wow. What?
In a 7 month span, he's going to do the 14.
That's, I don't
believe the previous world record was 7 years. 7 years, and he's
so how is this guy doing 7 months, bro?
I love how it starts. It's the whole documentary is like it's used of 100 hours of footage.
Yeah,
you get surreal scenes from the mountains and the videos. These guys, he takes 10 other people, like his friends, people he can trust the most, people who want to join him on this.
Yeah,
on this.
I guess you have to.
So this guy, seriously. So this guy's from Nepal. They get so unrecognized, and even though like Nepal is like the home of mountaineers, on the world stage, they don't get their respect, but they really are. Right. It would be like they're the boys who are born in the mountains, around the mountains.
Okay,
right.
Okay.
This guy's only been like a mountaineer for 10 years.
What?
And in 2018, he decided this is his dream. He wants to do this. He needs to find the money as to how he's going to fund this thing. Right. Mm-hmm. So he starts going around and he's trying to get people to like fund him and like believe in his dream.
Yeah.
And people really aren't buying it, right? But he's making noise around the mountaineer community because they're like, there's this totally crazy guy who says he's going to do this. And so he starts, and that's when, you know, noise starts being made.
Yeah.
He literally remortgaged his house to pay for all of this. His wife had to wait at home.
Not the mortgage.
And just hope and pray that, you know, he would live.
Damn.
The whole documentary is incredible, man. Dude's friggin' nuts. He became the first person to summit K2 in the winter without oxygen.
What? That peak is treacherous. That's in Pakistan, right?
Yeah. K2 Pakistan, yeah.
Yeah.
He had like a whole, obviously this was all planned out, planned out. The first one he does, I can't remember the name of it, is literally he starts off on the mountain that has the highest death rate.
Get it out of the way.
Get it out of the way.
Fuck it. If I die on this one.
No, it's encouraging for the rest of the, you know, journey.
If you can get it out of the way,
then everything else that follows.
So the first one, it's for every 3 people who successfully summit every year. One person dies.
That is such a bullshit ratio. I would not even touch that. I wouldn't even touch that in VR.
So, bro, this guy's nuts, man. And then he does Everest, and Everest has 2 other peaks that are like right beside it, and I can't remember the mountain names. They're all They're all Bing Bong and whatever, something else.
Yeah.
Bro, the man does.
Joe Byron.
We were talking Everest, you know, the average time to do Everest. They spend like 2 months, right?
Yeah, it was. Yeah,
he did Everest and these other 2 with his 10 other people.
Yeah.
In 48 hours.
What?
Wait, so they all completed it together in 48 hours?
48 hours.
That's okay.
I guess he was just already acclimatized to it.
Bro, the man, by the day like 28, he had done 5 summits.
That is freaky.
Yeah.
And like the weather too.
And it's scary, bro. It's not like, oh, this is all like, it's so cool to see this, bro. There's deaths that happen.
Some of his crew members died?
I won't spoil. Oh my God. I think this is a great watch.
Okay, so we got to watch this.
Yeah. There's absolute great watch. Anyone listening, 14 Peaks, great watch. The guy's name is Nims Purja.
Yeah.
His actual name is Nimraz or something like that. Anyways, Nims Purja. He's on Instagram now. The dude's become famous.
And when he was
doing
Nims.
This, and when he was doing this, it was very unknown.
More famous than the guy with the artillery shell up his ass?
More famous, hopefully.
So I hope.
Hopefully. But you know what? Shout out to the artillery guy, though. He's high on my list. He's high on my list. I know what it's like to slip.
Yeah.
Come on, this happens, bro. Come on. It happens.
Do you guys remember seeing the video of the guy who's like, brother, I have broken my fast during Ramadan. I slipped in a shawarma, fell in my life. That one kills me. And
classic.
A cup of water.
And then a cup of water dropped in my mouth too. Is my fast still valid? Oh my God. The imam is like...
When was that? Like a year or two ago? Bro, that was hilarious.
That was
extremely relatable.
It's amazing. You have people doing that, calling in, asking those questions. Yeah. You have a guy shoving an artillery shell up his ass, and then another corner of the world, there's a guy climbing fucking...
Yeah, summit 14 peaks in 28 days.
And it's just like, there's levels to this.
Yeah.
And so he wanted to climb it in 7 months, you said.
That's insane.
Yeah, so in 28 days? Bro, the documentary is still worth watching regardless of a little spoiler. Okay. He ends up doing it in 168 days.
Oh, my God.
So he did it in 6 months, just okay. under 6 months.
Okay, we got to watch that.
So you can watch it.
Certified
he,
fresh?
He survived.
Michael reviewed?
Yeah.
Okay, certified. So question. This is a gold standard. Phone on or off? Like, are you putting your phone down for this watch?
My phone was off.
Perfect. Yeah. That's a benchmark right there.
Wow.
That's insane.
Yeah, I'm definitely have to check it out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, it's an incredible watch. Dude's like... Stuff like that, I love stuff like that because yeah. I can't even imagine, bro. Like the amount of people that were around him too who started taking notice, and then would on the documentary there'll be a parts of it. They'll talk to you what this mountain is like.
Yeah,
they've been to this mountain. They've failed like 5 times.
Yeah,
I've been on this. I've done tried this summit 5 times in the last 13 years. I've never been able to do it.
And this guy just fucking.
And this guy just does it wow. like it's you know he goes past people and everyone else yeah. is looking at him like who the hell is this guy?
Yeah, freak. He's a freak, man.
But the descents are like the scariest
parts. Oh my God, yeah.
The descents, really? Well, in this documentary, when they go through, that's when trouble happens, you yeah. know? What? That's when like, well, you know, you get back to base camp and they realize someone's not with them.
That, and you can-
And what? It's like, where does the person go? Are they dead?
Yeah, and the accuracy, obviously, of the forecast, like you got to make the best weather has to be on the way up just mm-hmm. to get it done, right? Yeah. And then God knows the farther out you are, it could change. So
wait, I thought like, okay, once you summit, like for example, for these people that are yeah. actually professionals, right?
Yeah.
Wouldn't they like have a way to get down? Like
you're too high up.
Wow.
Right. And then
yeah, your way down is your
and
way.
It's
up.
Also like cheating. Yeah, yeah. Like it's like the accolade yeah. of like I'm sure at a certain point mountain rescue, like they're you know they can help that's retrieve what I'm, yeah, you, yeah, but yeah. like that's also like well then does it count? Mm. You know what I mean?
Being retrieved.
Yeah. Yeah. Yoink on to the next one, drop me halfway
yeah.
up.
Yeah,
it's like an amazing race, bro. Like yeah. you take a helicopter to the next point.
Yeah, yeah, not fair.
Cal, give us an article. Yeah. You got a lot of notes today.
No,
man.
Yeah. So no, I was. It was not too many notes, but another invention for you guys.
God, the guy's got inventions today.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I got
Thomas Crapper,
the snow cone.
Okay.
Okay. All right.
Oh my God.
Now ice cream obviously was. They say it dates back to even 200 BC China. They used to
China
yeah,
ice
they used
cream?
To have ice cream.
I thought they were lactose.
Something similar to okay. it.
Yeah, I feel like I've heard so, this. Yeah.
So with snow cones, actually, it came about through an act of generosity. So there was a world fair in St. Louis in 1904. So they had like an ice cream stand, and the people were lining up. It was getting crazy. So the owner actually ended up running out of ice cream bowls. So the booth right beside him, there was a guy named Ernest Hemwe that had that booth open, and he was selling Persian waffles.
Okay.
So he saw that, you know, his neighbor here is running out of bowls and there's crazy amount of customers waiting there. So what he decided to do was roll up the Persian waffles into like a cone.
Yeah.
And sent them over to the booth next to him. And it actually became like crazy because people fell in love with it.
Yeah. Mm.
And that's how snow cones were invented.
And are you talking about ice cream cones or
ice cream
cone?
Ice cream cones.
Yeah, ice cream.
And so that's
snow cones. Yeah.
Ice cream cones. Yeah. So that's how an act of generosity got us to ice cream insane. Cones. Yeah. It's actually nuts.
That is wild.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes the creations of things are just, they so stumble. Random. It's always stumbled upon, right?
It's always yeah. accidental, yeah. yeah.
That's why I wondered, I did see another fact, and I always, sometimes when you hear interesting like facts about an insect or an animal, I always wonder, how did they figure this out?
Yeah.
yeah.
So there's another thing that I remembered reading. I did a lot of reading this week, and reading's, before I get to my point, I feel like reading, and like whether it's even just watching YouTube videos, I feel like that's like your brain's version of the gym.
It's a reset.
yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's a reset.
Feels really good after, and you've learned something, and you just feel like healthier.
For sure.
Inside, you know?
Easily.
So I stumbled upon this random thing, and I wondered how the hell did they figure this out? Mm-hmm. But there's back in the 1800s, there's a guy named Dolbear.
Dolbear.
And okay. it's Dolbear's law is that the cricket, when they make those cricket chirps, the chirping sounds, you can tell by the cricket's chirps what temperature it is, what temperature the Ooh. Air is.
What?
What?
But like the pitch of it?
Not by the pitch. So every 15 seconds that pass, you count the amount of chirps that the cricket does mm-hmm. and then add 37 to the number.
Like to get Fahrenheit?
to get the temperature of the air in Fahrenheit.
Wow.
And what? It will always be within 1 degree of the actual temperature.
So they're keeping temperature?
So wow. no, what their chirps are, their chirps are for many different reasons, but their chirps are, a cricket's chirps are for sometimes to attract the females.
Yeah.
sometimes just because they're like chilling.
Yeah.
And sometimes, but it is essentially how fast they are chirping is due to the temperature that is outside.
Interesting.
Once it hits room temperature, they chirp a lot slower.
Interesting.
Maybe to conserve energy, stuff like that. But this guy, Dolbert, back in the late 1800s or something like that, figures out.
No internet back then. No Instagram.
But he creates this mathematical model.
Going on YouTube.
To figure out that, okay, I'm stopping it at 15 seconds.
Yeah.
And then I'm matching it with a friggin'... They're basically nature's thermometer.
That's insane.
If you've got crickets around,
yeah,
check it out and then check out what the temperature is. It's insane.
Yeah, I guess that's probably one day he's like,
I have to go outside and trap a cricket.
Yeah.
Yeah, facts. I wonder how, though. That's another thing too, right? Like when it's winter, it's not like you're hearing crickets.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. So maybe you just noticed like you had lizards or something and he's like, wait, they make less noise like in the winter. His house is obviously probably, a bit colder. Yeah. He's like, why is that? And then probably led him to the conclusion, maybe.
So freaking weird, man.
So he's like, okay, they chirp less when it's colder, but like how do they decide to chirp less? And then he started digging into it. That's crazy.
Paying attention to detail like that, man, that's... insane.
And nowadays, when people are trying to pay attention to detail, attention spot. All of a sudden you're paying attention, and then there's a flip in the video, and it goes bing bong.
Yeah.
And you're like, damn, that was a good one. You keep scrolling.
That's it. And it's done. It's done.
So,
like, even it's crazy because even how, like, just how you're talking about stumbling on things again, like, there was actually a pharmacist as well. Like, his name was John Walker. He was a British pharmacist. So, like, in the early 1800s.
Johnny,
right?
Walker. Johnny Walker.
Johnny Walker.
Did he
John
make a whiskey? Is that a whiskey?
No.
Johnny Walker?
He created, well, it was by luck again, matches.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So one day he was like, so he's a pharmacist. He was mixing up some medicine with some wooden sticks. And then he noticed on one of the wooden sticks, there was like a little substance on it that was stuck on it.
Yeah.
It wouldn't come off. So he used another wooden stick to like try to scrape it off.
Yeah.
And as he was trying to scrape it off, it lighted a fire.
Yeah.
And he's like,
back to the caveman days.
Yeah. Well, no need for electricity let me just use this. So then that's how matches were invented, and he went on to like actually sell them and use, like, he would include in the packaging like sandpaper so that you can just start off your fires.
Wow. Yeah. So matches with like a red, so white matches white can light on anything with friction. Yeah. The red can only light on like the other
materials. Yeah.
That's a
good point too. I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
I think that fire is the funniest thing with how it doesn't matter how far into the future we'll go. Fire is the one thing that just gets our attention.
It's so primal, man.
Yeah. It's so primal.
Fire, everybody chills.
Exactly.
It's an immediate vibe. Stare.
Yeah.
You're calm. It's just the quickest way to.
Even to this day, we have the internet, we have movies.
But it doesn't hit different like a real fire.
But people will still go out their way to go do a bonfire. Yeah. Be like, hey, let's just go
do a bonfire. It is the one thing that will never die.
What's the biggest bonfire you've ever been to? I've been like a hillbilly one. Bro, throw couches and shit.
I'm not. I'm too much of a city boy to have been to some sort of massive bonfire. Yeah.
Dude, it was crazy.
Yeah.
So one of these houses we went to was like a trap house.
A real one.
Ooh, okay. Yeah, like a real trap house. Okay, I can't remember. It was somewhere in Oshawa. So
Also trap house.
So this place used to be a fucking grow up. So like it was basically like this massive property, and they literally had spaces in the garage and the basement, like bolted, like everything was still like padlocks, like doors. It's crazy. Like the basement, it was so freaky, like where they basically seized everything. And it was like a house was used for like a grow up. But bottom line, the people who decided to rent this place over, like I'm sure it was super cheap because it's just like, it's a drug house basically.
Mm-hmm.
But these people would have this massive fucking bonfire, and they would throw like old furniture and people like it's like a once a year thing. And like you bring shit and you just like toss it in, or like
burn it
and like old pallets and shit. And you just toss them in. And these guys had like gasoline and everything. It's hilarious. When there's a big fire, people just want to do stupid shit.
Yeah, like
you
jump
just
want to
do something stupid.
Yeah, it brings the crazy
animals. People become animals, bro.
Yeah.
But it's true too. Like when you're lighting a candle, it's so different when you get a match and you light the candle versus like a lighter.
When you use a lighter.
It's almost like there's something just. Not that anybody's a pyromaniac because
you
here,
kind of
but
feel
like
you've done something. You're the one that actually started the fire.
That's
you know, I actually did something here.
Yeah, facts.
I built it.
Yeah. Pat yourself on the back. Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
100%, yeah.
I just discovered fire.
Yeah.
Good job, Colin.
Yeah. I rediscovered it.
I rediscovered it.
Bozo.
Hello, Bozo.
Yeah. Fire is always going to be interesting, man. And you know, like, honestly, the vibe too, when yeah, I would love to have a house with like a fireplace indoors.
Absolutely.
You just have one running and just the crackling of it, the ambience of it. There's something so soothing.
Yeah. Oh, the crackling too. Yeah, it's the sound, it's the image, it's everything. It's the warmth, heat, the warmth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The smell of the, yeah.
Like
the
at
wood.
A cottage. Yeah. Oh my gosh. It's the nicest thing.
Mm-hmm. They even have, what's it called? Like even candle scents with like those kind of scents, right? With the fires and stuff, right?
Yeah, they do.
It's crazy.
You guys ever driven by like a candle factory?
No.
Never. No.
Where? How would
we know? Where the hell are they?
You would know by the smell.
Oh, really?
What? It literally makes the entire area around for blocks.
Okay, you'll so where's smell. The candle factory in the GTA?
There's one actually right by my work. It's at Tompkin and Britannia.
You just doxed yourself.
Well, that's not at my work, so they still got to look.
Okay.
Yeah. Do your Googles.
Still got to look within a certain radius.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
But no, it's the moment, and you know, depending on the time of day, it's gonna smell different.
Yeah.
Sometimes it'll smell like chocolate or you know stuff like that.
Are you sure it's not a bakery?
World's biggest bakery, Tompkins and Britannia.
It's got the whole time they've been making cookies.
I know it's a candle factory, but I didn't know until like weeks later when I would always say, "Man, every time I drive by this area, it smells so," and you can smell it in your car with the windows completely up.
So.
And it's like, man, this smells so good in this area. And then, you know, I would say that to like coworkers so many days in a row. Man, it always smells good there. And like, yeah, it's because that's the candle factory is like right there.
I like how we've come full circle with this podcast, this episode. Beginning, we're talking about shit.
Yeah.
And we finish now, off by talking about the wonderful aroma of candles.
That is how we do. And you know what? Yeah. For the first time this episode, and this isn't bringing it up really, but we never mentioned a certain man by a certain name. Not once did we bring him up.
Give me my flowers.
Bring that man up.
Yo.
Give me my flowers, man.
Yo, honestly.
Give me my flowers while I'm here, damn it.
Honestly. That'd be sick, though, if there was a candle and he was in it, like a little action figure. Honestly, business idea.
That smell would be rock solid. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
Yo, this guy.
Honestly, I would love to do that. Like, I'm sure we would get sued pretty quickly for IP.
No, definitely.
Put his face on the candle.
Yeah,
and say smell and call it action movie star candle. Yeah. Smells like action movie, right?
I sent you the image. It's the four boxes and it's all him.
Yeah.
And it's four different movies. It's like it's literally the same freaking guy.
That's so wild, man.
This is so stupid. Look, so man's stupid. Coming out with like 10 different movies a year at this point.
Yeah.
And they're all the same and they're all like real close.
Just hang it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dwayne, do your own research.
Oh, damn it.
Did what?
I didn't say his last name.
Okay.
Right. Oh.
Callie, hit us with the outro.
I was hoping you wouldn't say it, bro. We almost did it.
Hit us with the outro
before we screw up.
Before
Dwayne Johnson.
Dwayne the Rock. Okay. Hit us with the outro, bro.
We ruined it. Guys, episode 26. We appreciate you guys for tapping in. TikTok, everybody that's been watching on live, we appreciate you guys as well.
Yes.
And we'll catch you guys next week, man.
Thanks. Beautiful.
Episode 26.
That's it.
We out.
Why did you have to bring him up?
I never said a name.
Bro, and I was out here because I'm always the first one to mention it.